Welcome to the Steady On, Stronger Together podcast. I am your host, Angie Bauman. Today, I welcome Mary Rooney Armand, who is a wife, mother, writer, and a dedicated volunteer serving with four mission organizations. She joins us to talk about a passion of hers, celebrating and investing in friendship. Throughout our conversation, we talk about making, keeping, and losing friends. We discuss why friendship is important and how we can learn to better navigate some of the unavoidable heartache that comes into any relationship where we take the risk to love someone. Mary's wisdom and insight opened my heart to a renewed gratitude for the women in my life I am blessed to call friend. It also heightened an awareness in me that my friendships need intentional prayer and investment in order to thrive. Let's listen in. So hello, good afternoon, at least Central Time, Steady On friends. I'm so excited about this conversation today, and I'm glad that you guys are joining us because my friend Mary Armand is here, and she talks. She's going to talk to us about friendship. She writes about other things too, but she's going to talk to us today about friendship, and I think this is such a wonderful subject for us to talk about with a Christian perspective. And so thank you, Mary, for being here with us today to talk about this. And we're excited to have you. I always have to do a couple of little clicks to get started so I can see comments and all that stuff. So if you're watching, anybody watching live, put up a little hello and we'll know that you're out there and we'll be able to say hi back to you. But Mary and I met, I've been saying this a couple of times recently, but we met through Shannon Popkins' Comparison Girl launch team. What a fabulous project and what a fabulous group of ladies. Wouldn't you agree? Like, I feel like I've made some like real connection there with some people that have turned into, you know, some friendships. And I just really appreciate that. And maybe I'll ask you the question when you get to talking about different friendships, what kind of friendship is that? When we kind of overlap for a reason, I think that'll be maybe what you say. Yes. For a reason. And then something develops from that. So we met on that launch team, and Mary's coming to us from New Orleans. She lives in New Orleans and she is wife to Corey and mom to four. And Lisa Wood says hello already. Hello, Lisa Wood. And she serves as a dedicated volunteer. And I think, Mary, we could probably have a different conversation all about this quite actually. But she serves as a dedicated volunteer in four mission organizations, including organizing trips with Compassion International. And when we had our pre-interview conversation, we talked a little bit about Compassion because our family has sponsored a child in Rwanda for 10 or 11 years.
That's a great organization.
Yes, and it is. We have really loved being involved in that organization. So that's been really good. And she also attends the Vineyard Church in New Orleans, which is a large church, and she organizes women's ministry there, or at least you have, right?
I'm not over it. I've just been a volunteer on a team.
I think that I'm going to guess that you take volunteerism, though, to a significantly professional level. I just sense that about you. So she's written a Bible study called Identity. And look at this beautiful cover, friends. Isn't that gorgeous?
My son designed that cover.
No way. Yes. It's gorgeous. I love it. And it's available through Amazon. That's where I got it, isn't it? Did I get it through Amazon? Yeah. And I will put the link when we're done to that in case anybody's interested. And also her website is Butterfly Living. Just like it sounds, butterflyliving.com. And I'll put the link there in the show notes. .org. Thank you. Oh, good. I'm glad you corrected me because my notes say .com. Good. Butterflyliving.org. And I will put that in there. And what else, Mary? What else do we need to know about you before we dive into talking about friendship?
I am so excited because I have taught on friendship for a long time. Our church does these women's series, and it always seems to spin back to relationships. And I was sharing that I have a marketing degree and I used to market products, but really I've changed my focus to really identify why relationships and friendships, and especially our relationship with Jesus, it just has changed my life.
I have found in my own life that as my relationship with Jesus has gotten stronger and I actually have learned to receive more of my identity. I'm not sure that's the right way to say it, but understand more of my identity through him, that actually my relationships, my friendship relationships have grown stronger because I feel like
through him, I've actually had more to give, and maybe I was less easily wounded or offended because of my idea. Does that make sense? And so yes. I have found like there's a direct relationship in the health of my friendships and the strength of my relationship with Jesus. And so I think this is such a worthwhile discussion.
I agree.
I think it really begins in our own hearts, because we have to, this sounds probably kind of cliche, but we have to like be a friend, maybe as intensely as we seek to have friends. And I think we miss that part sometimes, you know, what yes. makes us a good friend. So
absolutely.
Mary posted a blog recently that caught my attention. That's why I reached out to her, and it was on friendship. It was on feeling a sense of belonging in friendships. That's been difficult for me at different seasons of my life. Most of my life, I would say, actually, I moved around a lot when I was a girl. And so I did not have consistency in relationships, which is just maybe one reason for that. But I also lacked skills as I grew in developing relationships and investing in relationships. And so so I just was really interested in what you had written. And she talks about the differences in our friendship, that some people come into our life for a reason, a season, or a lifetime, kind of like those three circles, or maybe you have a different word for that than circles, but kind of those three areas of friendships. And I just felt like what she wrote was really encouraging to me, and that it would be encouraging to more of you. So we're going to talk today about why we meet friends and how we keep friends and why we lose friends sometimes, which to me, I think I've always felt like when I lost a friendship that it was wrong or bad or disastrous, but it's not always, I think, is one of the things that I've learned as I've been reading some of your stuff. So get us started, if you will. I'll quit talking. I'll let you talk by kind of just unpacking the three types of friendships that you write about and the benefits of them or the differences between them.
I would love to. So the first thing I was going to say, it's more fluid than like an outline. It's not like you meet someone and you put them in a category. But when you write, you have to explain what your intention is. So just going into it with that thought. But what this has helped me with is going into relationships on the front end, adjusting my expectations. And on the back end, if there's closure involved, understanding why. So it helps on both sides of different relationships I've had in my life. And it's helped me so much that that's why I've written about it, and I've studied, and I've put a lot of thoughts together. The three levels I speak of, or three groups, are reason. So what you described in the beginning, we met for a reason. We were on Shannon Popkin's launch team. And so we do lots of things. We might have a workout group. We might have a, I'll be on teams at church to put together maybe a woman's night. And you get together with a reason. And then you really like someone, but then you go your separate ways. And you may never see them again, or you may occasionally. So that's pretty normal. I think we only get in trouble is if we build up an expectation when we meet someone for a reason and then we connect with them, but then nothing happens. Sometimes we can get hurt and stuck right there. That's the first group. The second group is season. So this is the hard group, because this group we've connected with. We've gone, maybe we did meet someone in a reason setting, we connected, we've been together, hanging out, getting closer, and then this ends. It may be a move, it may be a change in circumstances, and it's a lot of times conflict. And that is just, it's painful. So I think the season is where a lot of us get stuck when we lose those friends that we had for a season, especially those friends we had gotten really close to, maybe for length of time, or we really confided in them and we thought they were going to be a lifetime friend, and then it ends. Most painful.
A season, I'm getting the impression that a season can be like a short season maybe, but it can be like a long season, right? Is that, yes. So
I've had both. I don't know about you, Angie, but I've had both kinds that ended.
I think about, what about workplace friends? I know you're not quite done with the list, but what are those more reason or season, do you think, or maybe does it depend? Because I know sometimes you get really close to people that you work with, and then maybe you actually wrote about this, and then you leave the job and you think maybe you'll stay close, but because you don't have that life overlap anymore. You really don't, right? So that was, yes, that would be like more for a season than maybe.
Yeah, but some, I have friends I've worked with. I have two very close friends still that are lifetime friends. Mm-hmm. And we met at work.
Sure.
A long time ago.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been friends 30 years. Mm. So those were reason friends, but you know, there's a lot of chemistry involved and the lifetime, which is the next
group. Yes, go ahead.
Mutual value and respect. So if I want to stay your friend, but if you're not really that interested for whatever reason, doesn't mean you don't like me. It just means maybe your cup is full or maybe you're going through a struggle. So when mutual, that's a big word because it has to be mutual to move into a lifetime friend. Mm. And lifetime friends are the hardest group because that's the ones you dig in, you forgive each other. Mm-hmm. You go through things together. That it's not the dreamy BFF. I mean, I know for me, my lifetime friends, we've been through a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And there's a lot of raw moments. There's a lot of growth. Mm-hmm. And so it's the most fulfilling, but it's also, I think, the hardest work. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's the three levels that I use in my life and that I've taught about.
Yeah. When we talked before, you talked about how a lot of times we're not taught to relationship well. Those are your words, I think. Talk to us about why you think that is or what that looks like, not relationshiping well, for lack of a better word, and how that affects our friendships.
Well, it's just anything in life that we work on, we get better, right? And for some reason, if we think relationships are just going to come naturally, which I did, mm-hmm. I didn't really work on them and I got stuck a lot. It's just like my daughter over this quarantine, she's become quite the baker but she's worked on it. Mm. She's Googled it. She's practiced. She's failed. She's gotten better. And now she's creating these masterpiece cakes and everyone's like, I didn't know she had it in her. Well, she really didn't 3 months ago, but now she does.
Yeah.
So it's no different. And people are the greatest investment. If we can put that time into a cake or whatever, imagine what it takes for people. And so I love people. I value people. So I try to work on getting better. I want to be a better friend. And that ties in with being, you know, Christ-like as well. Mm-hmm. You know, we just work on it, learn about it, try to understand. It's easy to complain about each other. It's harder to sit back and understand each other. So if all we're going to do is complain or look at the negative, then those lifetime relationships are really not going to be as fulfilling. You could still have them. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people can have lifetime relationships and not really work on them. Mm-hmm. But to be fulfilling and mutually beneficial, I think they do require work.
What does it take to understand a friend? What kind of work do you see is involved in that?
I think just like I'm trying to understand myself and grow closer to Christ and he reveals things, you know, just when I'm reading the Bible or praying or thinking or on a walk, something will come to me. There's something I have to work on. Mm-hmm. And that maybe that's why there's a problem. That it's me. So just being open to understand what's really going on and not be quick to complain. And also not complain to other people. Try to work it out with that person, whoever you're in the conflict with. They're the ones you need to go to, not six other people.
They're the ones you need to go to, not six other people. But how hard that is for us.
It's so hard.
Is it not to have what I call in our family, we call them the hard conversations. Like I'm actually going to try to love you well enough that I take the risk to have the hard conversation. I have done that recently with some close friends of mine, which I think kind of leads us into the next question about vulnerability. But one of the things I really felt like the Lord was laying on my heart was that actually you've got some women in your life who want to love you better, but you're not letting them know how. Like this part of this is on you. You feel like they won't get close to you or you feel like they won't speak to your needs, but you're not willing to communicate your needs. Right. And so because some of brokenness in my past, I kind of even close friends that have been in my life, you know, 15, 20 years, I kind of always assumed that someday you're going to hurt me real bad. Mm. And so I'm only going to give you as much as I think I can stand, even though I loved them dearly. Does that make sense? Yeah.
That's so common though. That is,
and
so
and the Lord really impressed upon my heart to say, I mean, what you're looking for in these relationships, you actually can have. It does take a little bit of risk, but you're going to have to step out and explain to them more about what you're feeling and what your heart is. And I'll say that has been extremely difficult for me, but very rewarding because they do love me and they do actually want to hear how they can be a better friend to me.
Yes. That's such a great point. I had a friend that is one of my lifetime friends. And I remember when we first met, we were working together. She's the one I actually write about this in the blog post. And I broke up with the guy, or we broke up. And when we were done, she said, "Do you know the whole time you were dating, I didn't know these things? I kept them all in. I closed myself off," just what you're saying, to protect myself because of my past.
Mm-hmm.
Not really nothing to do with trusting her. It was more myself. So what you're saying is so true. And as we grow and grow closer to God, and there's a more, we're more willing to be more vulnerable as we get confident in our identity in Christ, which goes back to your comment at the beginning.
The next question really that I had written down for you is, you and I talked about how true friendship creates space for vulnerability that people need. I thought this was so profound. I've thought about it several times, Mary, since you said this to me the first time, that people need room to grow and fail and search. And how does that help us with our friendship expectations? Because people are going to disappoint us. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so how do we navigate that?
Yeah, this is a big deal. And this first came to me when I wrote my Bible study, which I did not intend to write a Bible study. I just started writing and it just kept growing. And my butterfly living comes from transformation.
Oh, yes.
When our identity is in Christ, we are transformed just like a worm to a butterfly.
Mm-hmm.
And in that transformation, we become more like Christ. That's what we desire. So it's a marathon, not a sprint. And Paul speaks of this in 1 Corinthians 9. He uses running. My son runs cross country. I see what's required. It's a lot of intentionality. It's a lot of mistakes. It's a lot of work. And when we desire to be transformed into Christ's image, it takes time. So if it takes me time, then it's going to take my friend time. And it goes back to expectations. And I talk about this a lot too. Thinking someone will respond how I want them to, which we all have. I actually posted about expectations today because I think it's so can stunt us.
Mm-hmm.
We get trapped either trying to always fulfill others' expectations or being disappointed that other people are not fulfilling our expectations. So a big saying I tell my children and I tell myself, let people off the hook. So assume the best, give them a chance. If you wave to someone at church or at the school building where you're picking up each other and they don't wave back, assume they didn't see you. If your friend cancels dinner plans and you were so excited, assume something else came up. The thing we tend to do is assume it's us.
Yes.
We put it back on us. And most of the time it's not.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with us.
Yes.
But then we're holding that person accountable. We're not giving them room to go through what they're going through.
Because whatever they've done or we've perceived they've done has pushed on an insecurity in us.
Yes.
And they may not even be aware that they've done it, but the enemy also gets in here and push and lies, right? And pushes on that insecurity even more and says, well, they never liked you anyway, or whatever. And instead of remembering how faithful they've been as a friend, like you're saying, and giving them the benefit of the doubt, we go immediately towards offense, right? I feel like one of the things that the Lord has taught me is that the closer I am with him, the slower I will be offended, because I think being offended is something that causes us, that's a slippery slope fast, because we'll react, overreact, all of those things. And I think in friendships, man, we can shut things down. And like you said, don't give people the benefit of the doubt and decide that they've done something, you know, unforgivable or whatever. So
and this goes back. Yeah. This goes back to what I was saying earlier about working on something. I find in my life, the more I've worked on letting people off the hook, you'll forget. You might, you get upset, of course, mm-hmm. it's natural. Mm-hmm. If you were excited to go to dinner and your friend, you know, has to change the plans. But if you know, that's not a pattern.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's a different conversation when mm-hmm. you are in an unhealthy situation. I'm talking about a good friend.
Yes.
And they're going through a hard time. In the last couple of months, they've been struggling. The more you practice letting people off the hook, mm-hmm. you're freer, first of all, and you forget. You don't even remember why that plan fizzled because you're not mm-hmm. holding on, and that spirit of offense isn't jumping on you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm going to circle and read a couple of comments to you. Lisa says, I agree, friendship takes work, but the work is a good thing because those deep, meaningful relationships are the most rewarding for me.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yes, mm-hmm. Lisa, so
yes.
true.
Yes. And she says, and again, she says, expectations are huge. Your comments on that are spot on. So I think that's true. And I don't know. I don't think we can have 30 really close friends.
No.
Do you? I don't either. I mean, like we might have, you know, 30 like season friends or something, you know, like where we have groups of people that we just enjoy. But I don't think we can really work on and invest in very many close, what you're calling lifetime, you know, developing lifetime friendships with people.
I mean, he's, mm-hmm. look at, he had 12, yeah. but he was right. really closer to even a smaller circle. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He's a great example of being a good friend.
Mm.
You know, he walked beside, I always wonder, he had to.
And let people off the hook a
yes,
lot.
They could do this. I mean.
Let people off the hook a lot. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so absolutely.
He's our model. That's who yeah. I try to model.
Yeah. So I loved what you said when we were talking about qualities that are necessary for a good friend. You said two people pursuing Christ takes a lot of the selfish out. I want you to talk to us about that just a little bit more. I love that. Takes a lot of the selfish out, because I think what we've been talking about with expectations so many times, I'm going to say this and then I'll let you answer. I've been married for 22 years almost. And I'm very honest about the fact when I got married, I thought a lot more about what the marriage would do for me.
Yes.
And what my husband would do for me than what I would do for it or the marriage or him, right? Like I didn't, yeah. So, and over time, it's kind of, well, maybe most recently, even I'm like, oh, wait a second. Part of what I'm supposed to do is like, you know, support him and not like it's just like a revelation, but you know, still there's this like this unfolding of the more I know Jesus, the less he encourages me to make it less about me and more about others. And just like that's true in a marriage, it's true yes. in any relationship, I think, absolutely. So talk to us about your experience with how pursuing Christ helps us take the selfish out and why that's good for friendship.
Yeah, well, yeah. You know, Christianity, that's the whole focus. Less of me and mm-hmm. more of him. That's why we have a relationship with Christ, to elevate Jesus and reduce myself. So if I long to be more like Jesus, then I long to be less selfish. I long to sacrifice more. And the whole premise of that comes from 1 John 1:7. If we are living in the light as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. Mm-hmm. So if we're both living in the light, I don't know if there's anything greater than that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just to pray together. I just got back from a beach trip with two very close friends, and to be able to open our hearts, share some of our deepest struggles and know it's safe.
Mm-hmm.
Give, just sacrifice of yourself. Say, no, I'll do that. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that can exist, maybe in a short amount of time.
Yeah.
But if you're talking about these lifetime friends, I mean, you can fake anything or you can do things for different reasons, but these deep friendships where you really, really mutually value each other and really care that you're a good friend to that person. It's not only freeing and, as Lisa said, rewarding,
mm-hmm.
But it's really the only way, in my opinion.
There's a sense in which, for me, I'm interested in your thoughts on this, that we can only serve without being exhausted to the extent that we're getting a filling for something. And if we have our expectation that the other person is going to keep filling us, then we're going to be dry, right? I mean, I think that's right. Because they're not always going to, but if our filling comes from something that doesn't exhaust, that doesn't dry up, then we can serve each other and not need them to react or respond in a certain way in order for us to get our filling too. And I think that's right. what that light is about, right? Absolutely. When we read the scripture again, is it in front of you still? Because I want to.
Yeah. If we are living in the light, in the light, then mm-hmm. we have fellowship.
Right.
And that's what I seek in my friendships. Mm-hmm. I want fellowship.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Not just a warm body to hang out with.
Right.
I would like fellowship.
Right.
That's the key where pursuing a relationship with Christ. And I know my deepest friendships, we share that we're walking in the light.
Yeah. Yeah. Lisa says, I almost added that you can't have numerous lifetime friends. I think that's so true. And Stacy Thibodeau, I hope I'm not butchering your name. She's commenting yes a couple of times that she's agreeing very much with what you're saying. So that's awesome. So thanks for watching, Stacy. So here's a thing that is really true. We gotta do this part too. I'm confident you have. I'm confident most everyone who's watching or listening later, now or later, has experienced friendship loss. It is painful to trust someone and feel like they either left you, betrayed you sometimes. A friendship rift happens that you feel like is either not right or cannot be closed again. All of us, I think, probably have some wounds from someone that maybe we thought was a lifelong friend. Talk to us a little bit about that hurt. What's that do to us, and where do we go from there?
Yeah, and I think it's safe to say everyone, mm-hmm. we all share this.
Well, especially all of us, if we were junior high girls, we probably, right? At least if nothing else, in junior high, isn't that when the mean girl, I mean, you know what that feels like from an early age. And it hurts. It hurts deeply.
Oh my gosh. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because mm-hmm. I mean, when you form bonds and connections with anyone, and especially as you said, you trust, mm-hmm. given a piece of your heart, and that ends, and especially when you lose them to conflict, mm-hmm. that takes a long time to heal. Mm-hmm. You can maybe say it doesn't, but I just speaking from experience, those wounds take a long time. Mm-hmm. We can heal. It's just painful. We have to walk through it. And a few things that I jotted down, you have to acknowledge the loss and grief associated mm-hmm. with that. So a lot of times we won't want to acknowledge that. We'll say, I'm good. Angie's my friend now.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, goodness. Yes. We'll replace that one with someone else.
Yes. I was over her anyway. Mm-hmm. And so we just kind of bury that. But mm-hmm. I think for me, I've learned, acknowledge that hurt. I really thought we were going to be lifetime friends, and I'm very sad. Mm-hmm. But the neat thing is I can also cry out to God, and I can process with a close friend or two mm-hmm. and walk through it together. And again, Jesus was betrayed. I am sure, you know, he felt a lot of pain. He was betrayed mm-hmm. when they fell asleep at the, you know, when he went and he wanted them to pray. And then I'm sure Judas was doing things along the way that betrayed him because he was stealing.
Right.
So I think it's good to cry out and say, I'm hurting. And then give yourself time to heal. Now, I'm not saying you crawl up in a ball. You do look, God will replace, you know, that person with people as time goes on. But you do need time to heal and to process it. And then the biggest obstacle is forgiveness. So as you're doing all this, you have to forgive the person. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean you forget, and it doesn't mean you'll be friends again, which I love your story. You told me, you know, that it does sometimes come back full circle. Mm-hmm. So I'm not saying you can't come back to that person, but the point is whether you do or you don't, forgiveness has to happen, or that will eat you up and really destroy future relationships.
Yeah, so it creates an opportunity to poison other friendships too, because I think that it places this seed of doubt in your mind. Well, if she did that to me, maybe she will do that to me, or, you know, whatever.
Or maybe I'm not that good. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, maybe my value's not that great because mm-hmm. I thought that person loved me. Mm-hmm. All these thoughts, you know, could go round and round in our mind instead of crying out to God, talking to people, you know, reading. There's so many scriptures about friendship, and there's so many Bible characters that went through so many things. It just encourages me. Mm-hmm. And then as you do this, it empowers you to move on. You are able to forgive, mm-hmm. which forgiveness can be a whole nother discussion.
Yes.
And then you can move on.
Yeah.
And then when you're really free and you can pray for that person, it's a great thing. You just, again, let them off the hook.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I have a friendship that's been out of my life. I'm trying to think. When I first started college, I was in a very difficult season of my life. I had abuse during my high school years. And then I went to college at 17 and was basically alone for the first couple of years without like community support around me. But the saving grace in my life, and I actually think it may have saved my life, I'm not exaggerating, was a group of ladies. I worked in the financial aid office at a campus job that I had, and everything else in my life was like sort of falling apart and or had fallen apart and was just kind of like ashes around me. And there was a group of probably 8 young women. We were all college students for the most part. And I worked in this office and I got good at my job. So I had this like, you know, place, and it was a place where people respected me for what I did. And those women were so dear to me during that season. I feel like they held me up and in a way that they didn't even know, because they gave me a place of community and a place to belong. And those, I'm not close with any of those ladies, you know, that's been probably close to 30 years now. Yeah. A couple of them are in my life just a little bit, right. But most of them I'm not close with at all. Some of them I have no idea where they are, but the longer the time has gone by, the more I realize what a gift those friendships were at that really fragile season of my life. And so it does help me, I think, have a respect for, like what you're saying, the different, I use the word circles, but the different groups of friendships, and how those women were in my life for a season, but what an impact sometimes like not lifetime friends can make, right, in your life.
And you said grace, that's one of them. Mm-hmm. When I was talking to one of my friend Ann said, that's something you say all the time, is show grace. Mm-hmm. And that's just unmerited favor. It's just,
yeah,
I'm going to show you grace.
Yeah.
And that goes back to being off, letting you off the hook.
And at that point in my life, I needed a lot of grace. Yeah. I wasn't making some good decisions.
Well,
and I
was all,
right. Yeah. True. So true.
I mean, I need a lot of grace today.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Like, good point.
I will take all the unmerited favor.
Excellent. You know, and I think what I had no skills in being a friend at that place, like, you know, my broken. And so they just loved on me in a way that I could not love them back, you know. And I think about that sometimes, a lot actually, in terms of just their grace for me and the Lord's grace for me, and how important those people were at that season of my life. So Stacy says, forgiveness sets you free, and I could not agree more. And I think, you know, it goes back to like what we were saying with the friendships, that the more that we receive of Christ, the more we can serve in Christ. But also the more that we understand our own, like you were just saying, our own need for grace and forgiveness from Christ, and the more that we allow him to shower us with that in our own lives, the more generous we are to shower it onto other people.
Absolutely.
When we recognize our own need, our own desperate need for his grace, then we have an understanding that we're all in that. We all have a desperate need for his grace. Yeah.
Yeah. And like Stacy said, you know, when you forgive, you are free.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it is. It's very empowering.
Even if the relationship is not reconciled,
maybe
it should not be or cannot
that's
be.
Right.
But that doesn't
Anytime
mean there's
it's
not, enough.
Not supposed to be.
Right.
For whatever reason. That's just how life is.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we can all be gracious. We can all be kind. Yeah. And we can all forgive, regardless of the outcome.
Yeah. Lisa's saying, just a side note, I worked in that same financial aid department 10 years prior to Angie. Lisa's a friend of mine.
Oh, good.
And we talked about, all we talked about was Knots Landing. Well, good for you, Lisa. I'm glad you had your friends in the fight. I know you're showing your age, Lisa. That's dangerous. So, so share with us, if you will, a story. I know I told you, maybe share a story with us just about something that's taught you have a better understanding of friendship, just whether it's like for healing, encouragement. Just talk to us about friendships in your life. Just share with us just a little bit of what they bring to you.
Yeah, well, I can, you know, just preparing. I was out of town this week and I was with two good friends. I just really needed, you know, with all the things going on in the world, and all my children are now teens and young 20s, and I needed a last minute kind of recharge, and to just take a couple of my friends that I spoke of and to go have these deep conversations. That's very important to me. It just helps me jumpstart and get ready for the school year. So recognizing what you need is really important. You know, and my husband, I have a wonderful husband, and I can tell him, I feel like I need a few days. I need to.
I want to pause you right there because our husbands are not our girlfriends. I say that, right? Like, yes. I just want to pause you right there because I like sometimes I've made, my husband's name is Matt, I've asked Matt to be my girlfriends, not even knowing that I'm doing that, right? But our husbands are our friends. Hopefully for all of us, that's true.
Yes.
But they're not our girlfriends. Okay, go ahead. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, my husband says, that's a lot of words.
Yes. Please call one of your friends to say all that too, right?
And he'll also say he used all his words. That's all he's got.
Words today for you.
We're girlfriends. Like, we could be, you know, that expression, beat a dead horse. Like, we could talk about the same concept and just dance around it and just keep till everybody's got it out their system.
Yeah, I'll be done with my words when I go to sleep.
Yes, exactly. You know, and you can just weep together, you can laugh together. You know, one of my friends drove my car on the curb. And she says, I think I'm on the curb. I said, I don't think you're on the curb. She goes, I can feel I am on the curb. You are being nice. And we just laughed and laughed and laughed. It's not, my daughters are like, that's not even funny. But those moments, like, that's just golden. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just golden. So on the positive side, you know, and then on the, you know, but I've had misunderstandings. I have a very dear friend. We're lifetime friends. We had a serious misunderstanding. This is 25 years ago. We were both deeply wounded, but you see, we ran to God and then we came back and ran to each other. Mm-hmm. And there was crying and forgiveness. And the key was neither one of us. So now this is a 30-year friendship. Mm-hmm. This is 25 years ago. So we were 5 years in. It was pretty young looking back. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We both valued each other to do the work, to keep each other in our lives and forgive. And now we're so close. It's not even an issue what happened 25 years ago. It actually made us come closer together.
I think that's something that I'm still learning in my close friendships, is that actually conflict and misunderstanding is an opportunity to go deeper in your friendships. And I shy away from that sometimes because I'm scared of losing them still. And that's just my own insecurity. And I'm like, well, if I just don't talk to her about this, I think it will go away. And then I don't have to risk making her mad or losing her. And I want to do better at that because my friends are worth me doing better at that. You know,
but nobody likes conflict. It's not I love this. And my motto is, if I can forget, and most things that happen, I just let them go.
Yeah.
But if there's something stuck,
and
you just can't get it out, but just and you have to bring it forth and get it out there.
Yeah.
Work through it.
Yeah.
And those most lifetime friends, they're probably feeling it anyway.
Yeah. Sometimes I think if you let something sit a little while, when you're not like still hurt, you know, the same way or angry or whatever has happened, if you let it sit a little while and you still want to, you know, you still feel like you should visit it, then you probably should. Because it's not just going away. Like you said, it wasn't just a quick thing. And then you can let them off. You know, something happened that really, it's an opportunity to make your friendship better. Like, I want to tell you why this hurt me. If you can do it kind of from that, you know, from that perspective. So,
I was just saying, I was disappointed. I tried to get over it, but I'm still
yeah.
Yeah. But I tell you this, the majority of things with those good friends, you don't never need to say. Mm. That's the great thing. I can bring them to God and I get, you don't need to say that.
Yeah.
That person loves you.
Loves you. Right.
Mm-hmm. Why are you even, and I just let it go.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's so
I agree.
Mm-hmm. So much easier. And And that's what, you know, my friend Stacy and I have several friends. That's one thing we have in common is we can let it go.
Yes.
It doesn't even need to come up.
And sometimes you can celebrate later the letting it go. Like even you can say, you know, this hurt me at first, but I think I understand why or something. And that can be celebrated too.
Or when I was a knucklehead, I appreciate, I know I was not in a good place.
Because when I'm thinking about what someone did to me, I'm not thinking about the six times I might've done something that offended them and they let it go. Right. Yeah.
That's right. Well, I think we're all like that. Yeah. But the flip side is I'm sure I'm doing some things that, you know, and then God reveals those to me too and say that probably wasn't the nicest thing.
Yeah.
And then you can go back and say, I was really struggling.
Yeah.
And I kind of dominated the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate you being there for me.
Yeah.
I mean, how great is that?
Yeah. I think, thank you, I'm sorry, and I love you.
Yeah.
Need to be said a lot, like in our, you know, in our friendships. I think when we practice saying those things frequently, we're doing it right.
I say love, forgive, repeat.
Yes.
Forgive, repeat.
Yes. And thank you.
Much easier.
Right. Yes. Mary, this has been so great talking to you today. I really appreciate just your willingness to share with us some things that you have learned. It's made me just really appreciate, even as I've been thinking about doing this today, it's made me appreciate some of the women in my life even just more, because I'm just so blessed to have them. And I know you feel the same way about some of the women in your life. It made, when you were talking about laughing with driving on the curb, I was thinking just recently I had a photo shoot with two of my closest friends. We'd never done that before, and we had some pictures made together, and the lady, just great lady, who was taking the pictures, every once in a while she would say, look at each other and laugh. And the picture, it's all she did was say that. And we have these pictures of like wide open, like hello, like someone just said something, the most hilarious thing, and nobody, but it's the shared memories. It's just, it's just shared memories. And those pictures where we're like laughing so hard are like my favorites, because nothing was funny, you know, but we were just so enjoying our experience.
Yeah, I have a friend, my friend Stacy, we laugh.
Yes.
Nothing.
I'm like, I know.
That's not funny.
I know.
And she just makes me laugh. And
I know.
It is medicine. The Proverbs say it's medicine for the soul.
Yes. It restores the soul. Yes.
But I want to say before we leave.
Yes. Yes.
Anyone out there who feels they are not worthy, everybody can have a good friend.
Mm.
It's not like I'm anything, you know, I have worked hard. I'm sure Angie's worked hard. I don't want anybody to have the illusion that this comes easily to me, or everyone deserves a friend.
Yeah.
Everybody's got I think we have different personalities and different people need different numbers. And but everyone needs a friend.
Yes.
And God wants everyone to have a friend.
Yes.
No one is beyond having friends that you can laugh about driving on the curb with.
And
pray that for everyone.
I know. I really appreciate you saying that. I read years ago, there's an author, her name is Nicole Johnson, and I was reading one of her books, and something that I remembered from it from years ago, she talked about how every good friendship starts with an invitation. And if you think about all your friendships, you know, it was to a school something, or it was to coffee, or was it like, you know, there was somebody said, hey, you should do this. And it was the beginning of what turned out to be a beautiful friendship.
Absolutely.
And so I've thought about that a couple places in my life of, if I don't have the friendships, either the number or the depth, or because I think that's true even for current friendships, like a deepening of friendship starts with an invitation. And I think about that in my own life, like where, if I'm not satisfied with my friendship situation, where am I not doing the inviting?
Yes.
And to pray about that, because sometimes it doesn't just happen, like you said before,
that's right.
You know?
And I've had cycles as well. I think that's a great point.
Yeah.
Where you're feeling, you know, like you need another friend.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very important point.
Yeah. Mary, thank you so much.
Thank
you. Again, I want to tell everybody, and I will link these things in the comments and in the show notes if you're listening later. Mary's Bible study is Identity, Understanding and Accepting Who I Am in Christ, and it is on Amazon. And her website, where you can sign up for her blog posts and all that kind of good stuff, which are really encouraging. I encourage you to do that, is butterflyliving.org. So Mary, thanks so much. And we are going to sign out and say goodbye. Thanks to you for those of you who were watching and watching live today.
You.
We appreciate you and your comments and all that. And we will say goodbye. So
goodbye.
Peace.
Proverbs 27:9 tells us that a sweet friendship restores the soul. My conversation with Mary has reminded me of that truth in my own life. A big thank you again to Mary for generously blessing us with her words and life experiences. I am so grateful that our paths have crossed. Mary's website is butterflyliving.org, and that information, as well as a link to order her Bible study Identity, can be found in today's show notes. Thank you so much for listening, friend. I pray that wherever your day takes you, you are walking in the confident knowledge that you are a beloved, cherished child of God. Peace.